scripture for today is giving us something that we should be able to understand like that. It's something we should be able to accept with great simplicity. And yet, for some reason, it seems very difficult for us to accept so much into our hearts that we actually take the full comfort, the full grace, and the full peace that this scripture offers to us. So that being said, I'm going to begin at the 7th chapter of Paul's letter to the Romans at the 14th verse. This is Paul telling the Romans he has a dilemma. Paul says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold into slavery under sin. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing that I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it." Now we're going to skip to the 8th chapter, just a little few verses past this, the first verse. And end up, he says, "But I cannot do it." Then we go, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death, for God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and to deal with sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. It cannot. It cannot. Emphasis, my own words. And those who are in the flesh cannot, not emphasis, cannot, cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit. Since the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. May the Lord have a blessing to read. Lord, we pray that you'd open our hearts and minds, that not only would we be hearers of your word, but that we would be doers. And I pray, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditation on my heart, my Lord, would be acceptable in your sight. My Lord, my God, my rock, and my redeemer. Amen. Paul has a dilemma. And his dilemma is, he knows what God really desires for him to do. Paul was a very intelligent man. He was a Pharisee. He studied under the greatest of all the teachers of the Hebrew people. He lived his life as righteously as he possibly could, with the intention of keeping the faith pure, even so much keeping it pure, that he was willing to chase down this new Christian kind of sect thing that was out there running around and causing all kinds of trouble for the Hebrew people, for the Jewish faith, and locking them up in jail and standing there and approving as they were even being executed. Until he was struck down on the road to Damascus, and he came face to face with the Spirit of God through Jesus Christ, the Son was blinded and then changed. So he was not a dumb man. He was not an unrighteous man. But he was not a sinless man. And he had no way of getting rid of the sin that was in his life until he was on that road and he took in the Spirit of God through Jesus Christ. So now that sounds like some really heavy, deep theology and all that. But this really is a very, very simple matter. If we look over Paul's shoulders with our eyes, we can realize that our dilemma would be the same thing, or is the same thing, is the same thing. I know what I'm supposed to be doing. I know it through my prayers, I know it through reading the scripture, I know it through my experiences within the church, I know it within all the teachings that I have been given. But all too often, even though I know what is right, I do the exact opposite of what is wrong. And you go, well, that's not a good thing, Pastor. Why don't you just do what's right? And the problem is, I am a person of flesh and blood, and I'm a person of spirit. I have the flesh and blood needs, same as every other person who was ever born. And I have this inside me, this deep desire to love God with all my heart, my mind, my strength, and my will. But the two are in constant conflict within me, always rolling around inside me. And sometimes it's a simple matter. It's not something that is a life and death situation. But it's easier, I think, to understand if we see it in a simplistic manner and something that's not so threatening. For example, I have been on this odyssey, this big journey of weight loss. And I've been doing this for a number of years, really. It started off in Stroon Lake Church, as a matter of fact, one Sunday morning when I announced, I don't know what the hell I was thinking, but I was going to announce every Sunday morning, I was going to step on the scale in the sanctuary and announce what my weight was. Wow! Talk about a pressure. Why would I do something like that? Because I thought this was going to be the way. Because I would be too embarrassed to step on that scale if I wasn't losing weight. I needed something, a hedge, or I needed some kind of coercion to make me do it. So often in life, the same thing is true with so many things that we do. Well, I'm still doing weight loss. I lost 50 pounds. In fact, by the time I was in Stroon Lake, it's 60 pounds.
Yeah. And I kind of drove me nuts because I said, if he gets to 40, that means I got to lose weight. And he did.
So it's inspiring.
Amen.
However, it takes the veterans telling program, me weighing every day, talking to a care coordinator, typing in every single morning at 5, 6, 7 o'clock in the morning, checking in, doing all the things in order to do that. But even with all those kinds of things that are going on to keep me on the straight and narrow, I'll be sitting in my park lounge. And it's in the evening. And it's after dinner. And I know that I cannot eat anything after dinner. It just doesn't work. I wake up the next morning and I'll gain it. But I sit there and think to myself, wow, fruits and vegetables. That would be wonderful. Because I can eat all the fruits and vegetables I want. Everyone said so. So I go out to the refrigerator. I open the door. vegetable drawer, there's celery, there's some cucumbers, some carrots, hey, radishes, I like radishes. I think I was putting that, kick the door in. And I close the door, I go over and I open the freezer section, let's see what's in here. And lo and behold, you know those little blocks of chocolate chip cookies, those little ones, you can get them like a price shelter sometimes, buy one, get one free. And I found them, buy one, get two free. And there's three boxes sitting in there. So you're thinking, what would one little baby cookie do? So I pull one of the boxes out, and I struggle opening it, because it's hard to open, and I rip my tear, and I rip the whole lid off. So I put it under my arm, and I sit down in the bark lounger, and I start popping until the box is empty. And I wake up the next morning, and I see the empty box sitting there. I feel nothing but guilt and shame. Guilt and shame. Because I have this physical urge that I have to fulfill. In the physical. And God will not strike me dead in the middle of the kitchen or take my hand and pull me away from the refrigerator. So I do it. Now that's a simple little illustration. And it's easy to understand. But we can apply that to how many different places in our lives. How many different things do we see, do we involve ourselves in that we know better than that? But we know this can't be right, but I don't care if it's not right. And then we have the guilt and we have the shame. And when we have guilt and shame, seems like we try to fill a void that'll get rid of the guilt and shame, which makes us do more of the things we know we shouldn't do. And we do it over and over and over and over again. Now, the really amazing thing about this is what Paul is telling me here, and I think he is correct. I'm not going to argue with him and say he's wrong. God understands that. God actually understands my cooking mania. And God still loves me. And God is not going to destroy me. And God is not going to make me have guilt and shame because of that. And I go, how can this be true? And the thing that really seems to get in the way of all this, because how can such a thing be true? How could God let me get away with that? I mean, seriously. How could God let any of us get away with these kinds of things? We must have to do more. Surely we must have to do more. And maybe I could do better if I understood every single thing that's in this Bible. It says right out of your stuff God wants me to know. And I'm going to add, and do. What if I memorized every single word, every single verse, every single chapter, every single book in this Bible? I have all that knowledge. What if miraculously I can remember every single word? And every time I get into a situation that I don't know what to do, I can go right to the verse that would cover it.
You'd be Baptist.
I have a very good joke about that. But that would really take me away from where I am right now. Next Sunday, maybe I'll use it.
Closing hymn, Jordan.
All right, turn to hymn number.
I don't finish.
The problem with that is, I can have all that knowledge. My head can be filled. I can be the smartest Bible scholar that ever lived. I can hold so much theology that you have to chain me down or I would float into the air with the spirit of myself. Because the spirit of myself gave me all this great knowledge Everybody is envious of my great intellect and my intelligence and all the things that I know about the Bible, and I can do all this and I can do all that. But I would still be a sinner, and I'd still be doing things that I know that I shouldn't be doing, even though I don't want to do those things. And this is the reason why that would be true. Because no matter how much knowledge I have, I can never love like God loves. I can never have the perfect compassion that God has. I can never, ever have the perfect forgiveness of myself that God gives to me. And God even forgets what I did. It says so in the Bible. God says so. Jesus says so. I can't forgive myself and forget. And I darn sure can't forgive other people and forget like God does. I can't comfort the hurts that are in my heart, not fully like God does. I cannot take away the pain that I have suffered in my 72 years, not like God does. I cannot have the patience of God, who had Jesus Christ on the cross 2,000 years ago so that everybody in the world could be saved. And God is still on the cross waiting while people are trying to crucify Jesus. And that patience will last for the next 10 billion years if necessary. I don't have the patience to drive slowly behind a driver in front of me. Or the patience to be at a red light. And this happens all the time in the summer in Lake George. You sat there, it's red. It goes green. It goes red. What the? Yeah. So if I had the patience of Jesus, I'd get out of the car. I'd go up to the person. I'd say, sir or ma'am, I can't help but notice that you were sitting here and the light was red, but then it turned green, and then it turned red again. Now I'm figuring that you must have something really crushing in your mind or spirit, or perhaps you have a mechanical malfunction. So I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll go back and I'll sit behind you. And if you think I can have you of any service, let me know. Otherwise, I'll wait till you fix this situation and you drive away, and then I'll go. Now, you know in your right mind could ever do that. It seems silly, but how many times are we confronted with things that we have this emotion, we have this thing that says, this is unjust, this isn't the way it should be, I have no reason I should be suffering this consequence. There's no reason that I should have to take chemotherapy. There's no reason why my mother should have Alzheimer's. There's no reason why my uncle should lose his job, or my daughter should have her boyfriend leave her, or her husband divorce her, or whatever else is taking place. There's no reason for this. And I'm going to get angry and do something I wish I hadn't done. And because what the Bible says, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I can take all of my silliness, I can take all of that physical thing that's going on inside me, all of that sin that's beating at the inside of me, and I can drop it like a shabby coat at the door of God's house and never put it back on again. Never even remember it. And you go, that's too easy. That's too easy. You're getting away with something. Too bad. That's the way it is. People can't allow themselves to simply get it, to simply believe it. It's not that difficult. You know, back way back when, when Betty Crocker first came out with cake mixes, do you remember when they came out? The only thing you had to do was add a little water. Well, they wouldn't sell. They wouldn't sell. People weren't buying them. And they did a big study. Why weren't people buying these? And the study concluded that it was too easy. That it couldn't be good if you didn't have to do something. And so what they do? Add an egg. Add an egg, stir it in, and they flew off the shelf. Because now you have to do something. We don't have to do anything but believe. We don't have to do anything but believe. Because there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because God understands who we are. Even if we can't understand who we are, and an easy way to understand who we are, I'll take you to another simple little illustration. Remember the Wizard of Oz? Dorothy and everybody coming into Emerald City? All she wanted to do was go home. And only the wizard could do this for her. And she gets in there and she brings this to the wizard. The wizard is nowhere to be seen, but there's smoke and there's lightning and there's thunder. There's all this fire and everything is going on. And the wizard says, no, I cannot help you. And Dorothy runs behind the screen and she doesn't see this big, powerful wizard. She sees this little man. And he's got wheels and he's turning around this way and he's doing this thing that's big and thunder. And Dorothy says, Mr. Wizard, you are a very bad man. You remember what Mr. Wizard said? Mr. Wizard said, no, Dorothy, I'm not a very bad man. I'm just not a very good God. And there's no reason for us to try to be a God, because we can't be a very good God. We can't be a God of any kind. And God knows that. God understands that. And God has given us love anyway. All we have to do is take it in. And so here we are. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So now, what we can do is relax. And what we can't, what time is it anyway? That's okay. What we can do now is relax. Know that we have this. I know, you know, we don't have to reach for the sun, the stars, and the moon. All we really have to do is dance under the sun, the stars, the moon, and all creation with one another, with joy, singing joy to the world. The Lord is come, and dance and be with that joy. And know the sun and the moon and the stars belong to God. The whole creation belongs to the God. And we celebrate it free, without sin, without shame, because God understands who we are and loves us anyway. May God bless us. Amen. All right, at this time, I think we're going to take a